Good morning, class. Today we'll start with the third lecture of legal rights and duties. In this class, we'll read some essential topics which are requisite before we start with the Hoffelian analysis of legal rights and duties. So they would include, for example, what is the relationship between rights and duties, which means we start with whether rights and duties are necessarily correlative to each other or not. Now, as per Salmon, a legal duty is an obligatory act, and the act and it is an act the opposite of which would be the wrong. Duties and wrongs are correlative. The commission of a wrong is the breach of the duty, and the performance of the duty is the avoidance of a wrong. So it is a debatable question whether rights and duties are necessarily correlative. So there's a first view which says that every right has a corresponding duty, something which would be reading in the Hoffieldian analysis. So according to this view, there can therefore be no duty unless there is someone to whom it is due. So according to this view, there can be no right without a corresponding duty, or a duty with a corresponding right. Just as there cannot be a husband without a wife, or a father without a child. Now the followers of this view point out that every duty is a duty towards some person or persons in whom, therefore, a corresponding right has to be vested. Conversely, every right is a right against some person or persons upon whom, therefore, a correlative duty is imposed. So every right or duty thus involves a vinculum juris, or a bond of legal obligation, by which two or more persons are bound together. Thus, there can be no duty unless there is someone to whom it is due. Likewise, there can be no right unless there is someone from whom it is to be claimed. Now, you have other schools also, and you have people like Austin who have commented on this. Now, Austin says that every right implies a corresponding duty, but every duty does not imply a corresponding right. So, right of a debt implies a corresponding duty to pay the amount of debt to the creditor. However, as stated above, every duty does not imply a corresponding right. As it has been observed, it is duty of the magistrate to punish the offender if his guilt is proved in the court. However, it would be very it would not be a very good argument to say that in such a case, offender too has a corresponding right to be published, to be punished. That is the reason why Salmon talks about a different course of action, where he talks about duties, rights and wrongs. Austin says it is not possible. So Salmon is of the opinion that every right has a corresponding duty, and Austin says no, it might not be possible. So when it comes to the propounders of this other school, we give the reasoning that there's a difference between two kinds. So you have different kind of duties. One is a relative duty and one is an absolute duty. So relative duties are those which have rights corresponding to them, and absolute rights have no such, absolute duties have no such rights. So this school believes that the essence of a right is that it should be vested in some determinate person, and that it should be enforceable by some form of legal process to be instituted against him. Thus, duties towards the public at large or towards indeterminate proportions of public have no correlative rights. So also, the duty to refrain from committing a public nuisance has no correlative right. Similarly, where trustees hold the properties on trust for religious purposes, even though there is no ascertained beneficiary, the trustees are under a duty not to use the property for any other religious purpose. The question is, to whom is the duty owed? If owned to anybody, it must be owned to the public at large, or the state, or the crown. But it makes no difference whether one says that the duty is owed to the one or the other, or it is not owned to anyone. In any event, the law of the point is very clear, that is, it is a duty of the trustees to make the property make use of the property only for the purposes for which it is earmarked. Or you take the simple examples which I had given you in the class. There are certain duties which are self-regarding duties. For example, duty not to commit suicide. So when it comes to such a duty, can we trace right with someone? No. Then there is a duty to indeterminate persons. For example, duty not to commit nuisance. Here we had taken example of whether suddenly at 3 o'clock in night I can start singing. No, I cannot. But the question is, if I do it, then the right vests on whom? That is very difficult to determine. Then duty to non-humans, that is duty to animals. We are expected to behave properly with animals or not be cruel to them. So then after this, you have a very famous judgment to study, and that is Minerva Mills versus Union of India. So it may be towards the conclusion said that duties in the strict sense of term have corresponding duties, rights, but duties in the wider sense do not have. So that is the reason why we refer to the observations made in Minerva Mills' case. In Minerva Mills' case, it was stated that there may be a rule which imposes an obligation on an individual or authority, and yet it may not be enforceable in the court of law, and therefore not give rise to corresponding enforceable right in another person. But it would still be a legal rule, because it prescribes a norm of conduct to be followed by such individual or authority. The law may provide a mechanism for the enforcement of this obligation, but the existence of the obligation does not depend on creation of such a mechanism. The obligation exists prior to and independent of the mechanism of enforcement. Which means a rule imposing an obligation would not therefore cease to be a rule of law, because there is no regular judicial or quasi-judicial machinery to enforce its command. Such a rule would exist despite any problem relating to its enforcement. So this is regarding the co-relationship between rights and duties. After that, we have a very interesting topic, and that is, what are the objects of rights? See, we have read about the characteristics of rights. That is, you have an owner of the right, you have a person against whom there is a right, then you have a substance, you have object, you have title. Now you need to read the objects of right. So there are six chief kinds of legal rights with reference to their objects. First is right over material things. So here we would read about one's right over one's house, book, car, furniture, etc. Then you have right in respect to one's own person. So thus one's right not to be assaulted or falsely imprisoned by anybody, or rights in respect to one's person. Then you have right to reputation. Every person has a right not to be defamed by another, either by libel or by slander. Now the concept of libel and slander are something which we have discussed in class, and you have discussed this concept in law of torts also. Now rights in respect to domestic relations. These would include the marital rights, parental rights, and master rights over the servant. So violation of marital right can take place in three ways. Number one, abduction or taking away of man's wife, or adultery or sexual intercourse by a man with wife of another man, or causing physical injuries to the wife. So, violation of parental rights consists of seduction of a person's daughter or child. Then you have master's right. So master's right over his servant are violated if anyone who deprives him from the servant services of the servant by injuring or imprisoning him so as to prevent performance of his services, or by inducing the servant to leave the master's service wrongfully, or by harboring a servant who has left the service wrongfully, therefore, before the expiration of the stipulated period. Now, in addition to all these things, a master may sue for the loss of service caused by seduction of female servant. The relationship of master and servant must exist both at the time of seduction and at the time of illness causing loss of service. After this, we have the rights in respect of other rights. So in these cases, right has another a right has another right as its subject matter. Thus, by a contract of sale, the buyer acquires a right to the right of ownership over the object of sale. So towards the end, we read rights over immaterial property. And the examples of rights over immaterial property are patent right, copyright, trademark, and commercial goodwill. After this, we have the concept remaining concept of moral and legal right and the concept of legal wrong, wherein you would read about the Gloucester Grammar School case. Now, these concepts are very important because later on we need to read the Hofindian concept of legal rights, where we would be talking about co-relationship between various concepts. At that time, clarity insofar as these concepts are concerned is very essential. Now see, moral and legal rights. Rights like legal wrong, rights like wrongs and duties are either moral or legal. A moral or natural right is an interest recognized and protected by rule of natural justice. Thus, the mutual right of a husband and wife to be loved by the mutual right of a husband and a wife to be loved by each other is a moral right, the breach of which cannot be, in fact, remedied by the court as such. Now, a legal right, on the other hand, is an interest which is recognized and protected by the rule of natural justice. So rights, as Ehring says, are legally protected interests. Now, in order that an interest should become legal right, Salbert says that it must obtain not merely legal protection, but also legal recognition. The interests of beasts are to some extent protected by law, and in as much as cruelty to animals is a criminal offense. The duty of humanity so enforced is not conceived by the law as a duty towards beasts, but merely as a duty to respect them. Now, similarly, a man's interests may obtain legal protection as against himself, as when drunkenness or an attempt to commit suicide has become a crime. But he has not, for this reason, a legal right against himself. A duty to refrain from drunkenness is not conceived by the law as a duty owing by a man to himself, but it is a man, it is the one owing by him for the community. It is only interest that which receives legal recognition is that of a society in the sobriety of it and in the sobriety of its members. Now, after this, you have legal wrong. This is also what you have already done, but we need to revise these concepts before Hofindian analysis once. So, a wrong is an act contrary to the rule of right and justice. Its synonym is injury in its true and primary sense of injury. This term has acquired a secondary sense of harm or damage, whether rightful or wrongful. So wrongs or injuries are either moral or legal. The former is not, whereas the latter are considered by court of law. Now, insofar as the wrongful act is concerned, a wrongful act is an act contrary to the rule of right and justice. It may be of two kinds, a moral or natural wrong. That is, an act which is morally or naturally wrong, being contrary to the rule of natural justice. And number two, legal wrong. That is, an act which is legally wrong, being contrary to the rules of legal justice and a violation of law. A legal wrong is an act which is authoritatively determined to be wrong by a rule of law and is therefore treated as a wrong for the purpose of administration of justice by the state. The essence of the legal wrong consists in its recognition as a wrong by the law. It is synonymous with injuria, that is, the violation of legal right. So a mere loss, that is damnum, without the violation of legal right, that is injuria, does not give rise to a case of cause of action, though in some cases, injuria without damnum suffices to constitute a tort. Now, insofar as legal damage is concerned, damage in common language means the physical effect of the defendant's act. But legal damage or damage that constitutes liability in tort is neither identical with actual damage, nor does it necessarily mean any pecuniary loss. So every invasion of a person's legal right or unauthorized interference in his property imports legal damage. That is, although the injured person may not suffer any pecuniary loss by the wrongful act of the defendant, yet if it is shown that there is a violation of some legal right, the law will presume damage. So this is known as legal damage. Here we read about Gloucester Grammar School case, which you have already read in torts. So in this, the defendant schoolmaster sets up a rival school next door to the plaintiff school, with the result that the boys from the plaintiff school flock the two defendants. The plaintiff sued the defendant for the loss. It was held that no suit could lie on the ground that the bona fide competition can afford no ground of action, whatever damage it may cause. So free and fair competition is legal. So, but a competition in which legal rights of rival are infringed can be a ground for action. Thus, an action lies against the person for causing injury to another by illegally interfering into, let us state, business and employment. Thus, in Gloucester Grammar School case, besides setting up a rival school, the defendant had interfered with the plaintiff school by illegal means. As, for example, by procuring another to waylay the children going to the plaintiff school, or by intimidating them so that they cease to go there, the defendant would be liable. In such a case, the plaintiff would be entitled to damages or injunction or both. Now, another very important case insofar as this concept is concerned is Chasmore versus Richards. In this case, the plaintiff was the owner of ancient water mill near Croydon. For more than 60 years, the occupiers of the mill had been using and enjoying the flow of River Wandle for the purpose of working of the mill. The local board of health of Croydon, whom the defendant in the suit represented, sank a well in their own land and pumped a large quantities of water, with the result that the percolating underground water, which would naturally have found its way to the river and helped the work of plaintiff's mill, was obstructed. With the diminution of water in the river, the plaintiff found it impossible to work his mill. The plaintiff sought to make the defendant liable, but the court held that the doing of the act, which is otherwise lawful, cannot give rise to an action in tort, however much it may be attended with loss of the party complaining. Now you have one more very important case in this, and that is Rogers versus Rajendra Dutt. So it was held that it is essential to an action in tort that the act complained of should, under the circumstances, be legally wrongful as regard to the party complaining. That is, it must prejudicially affect him in some of his legal rights. So with this, we are done with the miscellaneous topics. And in the next class, we would be discussing about the Hoffieldian analysis of rights and duties in the wider sense of terms. Now, if you have any confusion or you need lack of clarity relating to any topic, please do get back to me. Thank you. Thank you.